Looking down from the plane, you see teeny tiny houses. It's simply because the distance between them and your eyes is too far. The similar thing happens when an object is far from the camera. It's very small. In that case, a wide area of the picture containing thousands of pixels are compressed in a single dot on the screen. So, which color should that dot be? In the first part of this series, we've talked about the PBR textures. Those images are applied on the surface of a 3D mesh thanks to UV. There are some softwares letting you paint directly on the surface of the 3D model, such as Mari, Substance Painter, or 3D Code. In fact, while you are painting on the 3D model, the result is projected automatically to some 2D textures, and the softwares update the textures immediately to help you preview the results. In order to let them know which part of the 2D textures should be projected on, you still need to provide the UV map. There's another way to explain the UV. Imagine that each vertex is a magnetic ball, and when the mesh is unwrapped onto a flat surface, each magnetic ball is split in half. The first half stays with the vertex, and the second half sticks to the texture. Then, whenever that texture is applied on the surface of a 3D model, each pair of the magnetic bone will try to snap to be stick together. These actions help the texture to be applied on the mesh. I love this way of explaining the UV coordinates, since it's very easy to relate another fact that each pair of the magnetic bone is always stick together, even when the mesh is animated or deformed. So we just need to focus on those magnetic bones and forget about the texture, because different parts of this texture have to be stretched or shrink just to follow the position of the bones. This is so interesting because it won't happen in the real life. If you consider a texture as a paper or a piece of a fabric, it might be torn apart. But in the realm of computer graphics, that texture is indestructible. It could be stretched to any shape and size. Let's see what will happen if we try to apply a much smaller texture on a bigger mesh. Remember our magnetic bones? Whenever each pair of them is snapped together, we could be confident that each part of the texture will be glued on the 3D mesh correctly. How can they do that? Because the UV coordinate is stored in a clever way. UV coordinate is a two-dimensional vector. Each component of this vector is in the range from 0 to 1. UAZ direction is from left side to the right side, and the VAZ direction is from the bottom to the top. By using the range from 0 to 1, the UV coordinates are relative to the texture dimension. Let's say we have a pixel with UV coordinate equal to 0.25 and 0.3. The U component equal to 0.25 means that the distance between that pixel to the leftmost edge is 25% of the width. And the V component equal to 0.3 means that the distance between that pixel to the bottom is 30% of the height. Now you know why the coordinate 1, 1 indicates in the top right corner of the texture. By using this relative coordinate system, the UV map is independent from texture shape and size. By saying that, I mean any texture at any shape and size could be applied on the 3D mesh surface without problems. Looking down from the plane, you see teeny tiny houses. It's simply because the distance between them and your eyes is too far. The similar thing happens when an object is far from the camera, it's very small. In that case, a wide area of the texture containing thousands of pixels are compressed in a single dot on the screen. So, which color should that dot be? For a clearer explanation, I use the term pixel to indicate small pieces on the screen and the term texture to indicate small pieces of the texture. In our current situation, many pixels are crammed in a pixel, and we need to pick a single color for that pixel. There are two ways to deal with this problem. The first one is picking the nearest pixel. It's simple and blazingly fast, but incorrect most of the time, because pixels are ignored and not contribute to the final color. Then we have another way. We can take all those pixels out and blend them together to find the final color for the pixel. This way it's more accurate but also less performant, since we need more CPU power and more time just for calculating the color for a single pixel. Moreover, the two methods both lead to the aliasing effect and the moire noise pattern. Don't worry, we have a better solution. Just create smaller versions of the original textures. On the screen, you can see that I mark different versions of the texture with multiple colors. Whenever the distance between the camera and the floor changes, texture different resolutions will be used. The bigger texture is used when the object is close to the camera, and otherwise, the smaller one is used when the object is far away. By using this method, the number of pixels contained in a pixel is as small as possible, and this method is called meat map. The texture at original resolution is the MIP level 0. Scale it to the half dimension and we have the MIP level 1. So on, the MIP level 2 is half the MIP level 1, and the MIP level 11 is half the MIP level 10. If you stack these MIP levels on top of each other, we'll have a pyramid, another common name of this technique. The first advantage of the MIP map, which can be easily spotted by naked eyes, is that the aliasing effect and the moire noise pattern are reduced. It means that the rendered image quality is improved. The second plus point when using a small enough texture is that the number of pixels need to be sampled is less. It means less work for the CPU, and the GPU cache also gets benefits from this, since wider area of the texture fits in the cache. On the downside, MIP map requires more memory to store the generated MIP levels. You want a specific number? It's 33% more. In Unity, you just need to turn on the feature Generate MIP Map in the import settings for each texture to use the MIP map. If you're thinking about checking all the textures to make sure the MIP map is on, then don't do it. MIP map is very useful, surely, but not for every texture. UI images or 2D sprites are rendered with fixed distance to the camera, so you won't get any boost for enabling MIP map for these textures. It costs you 33% more memory for each one. Obviously, do not use MIP map for UI images and 2D sprites. If the camera projection is set to orthographic instead of perspective, the distance from the camera to the projection plane is constant. Famous games like Torchfly or Diablo use this kind of camera setting with the name isometric. Combined with 45 degrees rotation, we get the camera settings for other famous games like Monument Valley or Final Fantasy Tactics. With these cameras, there's a big chance that just only one MIP level is used. Then I can say that MIP map is not really needed for games like these. In Unity, you cannot control the MIP map generation. So, in order to debug which MIP levels are being used, you need support from the game engine or the shader, or you can use the PBR text tool like I did before to modify the MIP textures. And notice that you need to use the DDX extension to let Unity import and use your MIP textures instead of generating new ones. Furthermore, with the link in the description part. With Unity's default settings, you can see that the texture sharpness changes suddenly at some distance. Those are the positions where the transition between MIP levels happens. The bilinear filtering option only helps you to blend surrounding texture in the single MIP level. You need to use trilinear filtering option to blend the textures between two continuous MIP levels. The reason is smoother MIP map transition. Besides these filtering options, you can study more about point filtering and anisotropic filtering. They're both useful in some specific situations, and you need to use the trade-off to make better decisions. Textures at different resolutions of MIP levels can still be applied on the object surface thanks to the relative UV coordinate design. To know more about the powerful UV map, you can find the full third episode to see how I apply the UV map in the Thin Mask technique.